بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
Okay, because a lot of the people, the entire argument for the people in Dawla is to say to them, leave them, leave them. Nobody agrees with you. You're all alone. Everybody else is against you. All the people they gathered against you. Yeah, give me good reason. Give us good reason. And they say to you, you make because they make takfir on everybody. I don't make takfir on anybody. What's it got to do with me? What's it got to do with me? You want to accuse me that you do this, you do that. I don't do it. I'm innocent. They say that to us all the time. Say, you're takfiri. You make takfir upon Muslims. I never did that. A'udhu billah. Okay? So why am I going to leave? Okay, leave the people around me because of an accusation you made it up. So the people, my advice to all of the Muslims, if you are standing for the haqq, standing for the truth, standing for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, making a stance against the enemy, against the disbelievers, against the tawaghit, for the sake of Allah, to establish the deen of Allah, to make the word of Allah the highest, don't turn back, don't turn away, stand firm.
If a little ant was able to speak, crawled over here on this desk, and able to speak to one of us, and they saw isti'ana in me or you, the ant told you, there's 100 ants coming after me at a distance, they're chasing me, they're after me, there's a tribe of them, they're gonna kill me. You wanna test the isti'ana of that ant in you. Is her isti'ana faithful or not? Do you just go run and crush those 100 ants and put an end to them? What you do is let them get closer and closer and closer. Not only do you test her isti'ana, the ant that saw isti'ana in you, but you also want to show the ant your power and your mercy. Now getting rid of those ants is no obstacle to you. You can do it by stepping on them when they're far away or when they get closer. It takes a millisecond to do it. But if those ants got real close, right in front of that ant that sought help in you, and then you stepped and killed them and eliminated them, it reflects on that one ant. You showed the ant your ability. You showed the ant your power. You showed the ant how merciful you were with her. You showed her how you fulfilled your promise. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. Allah has the supreme examples. Allah tests you to relieve you. Allah tests you to relieve you. Allah tests you to be merciful and compassionate over you. He lets matters get closer and closer and closer to you. Just when you think your isti'ana failed and the matter would never be relieved, He, Jalla fi Ulah, relieves you and aids you.
Al-Ummah. The Ummah who is what? The Ummah is known as Jama'at al-Muslimin. It is the greater Jama'ah of all the Muslims under one Khalifa, under an authority that will rule by whatever Allah revealed. If anybody is closest to Al-Jama'ah out of all those groups in Syria and Iraq, but it's the one that's implementing Islam. The one who's implementing the deen. You want to say be with the Jama'ah? That doesn't mean be with all the little pocket groups. The one running to Geneva, the other one FSA, the other one here, the one other. He's not by them. The one who wants to say, we're going to implement the deen. There's nobody implementing any law over the people. The people have no water, people have no food, people have nothing. The people are looting and robbing everywhere. We're going to implement the deen and protect the people and manage their affairs. They are the closest. But they are the closest. If you want to say, today, there's Jama'ah you need to be with, but it's those who are fulfilling that vacuum that the Ummah is needy for. So be with the Jama'ah. Don't leave just because people that are playing games and backbiting and slanting. Don't play their games. You stand for the sake of Allah, you stay for the sake of Allah. If you are on haqq because of evidence from Quran and Sunnah, you don't leave it for the sake of Zayd said and Ubayd said. You got Allah said, Muhammad said, is enough.
Bizim dava konusunda, akide konusunda hiç kimseden korkacak, hiç kimseden gizleyecek bir şeyimiz yoktur. Bu dava ve akide Adem Aleyhisselam'la beraber başlamış olan ve kıyamete kadar devam edecek olan bir akidedir. Bizim utanacak, bizim saklayacak, bizim korkacak hiçbir şeyimiz yok. Korkması, utanması, yaptıklarını gizlemesi gereken insanlar sizlersiniz. Çünkü sizler genel evi işleten ve buradan aldığınız vergilerle hayatınızı idame ettiren deyyuslarsınız. Çünkü sizler kumar evleri işleten, kumar evlerinden aldığınız paralarla hayatınızı idame ettiren kumarbazlarsınız. Çünkü sizler HDP gibi eşcinselliği, kafirliği, zındıklığı yeryüzünde yayan insanlara müsaade eden, onların faaliyetlerine demokratik faaliyet diyerek onların zulümlerine ve icramlarına ortak olan ve Allah katında onlarla aynı hükümde olan insanlarsınız. Utanacaksa eşcinseller utansın kardeşlerim. Utanacaksa deyyuslar utansın. Utanacaksa kumarbazlar utansın. Bizim utanacak bir şeyimiz, bizim gizleyecek bir şeyimiz yoktur. Ben hepinizin adına söylüyorum. Biz sizden ve Allah'ın dışında ibadet ettiklerinizden beriyiz. Biz sizlerin kafir olduğunu itikad ediyoruz. Biz bizimle sizin aranızda tek olan Allah'a bir iman edinceye kadar, bütün tağutları reddedinceye kadar, yeryüzünde Müslümanların arasında yer alıncaya kadar ebedi bir kin ve ebedi bir düşmanlık baş göstermiştir. Bu bizim akidemizdir. Bu sistem tağuti bir sistemdir ve biz Allah'ın bize imkan verdiği oranda kendimizle, çocuklarımızla, ailelerimizle bu sistemden uzak durmaya çalışıyoruz ve çalışacağız da. Biz askere gitmiyoruz. Bize askere gidiyor musunuz? Askere gitmemenizin sebebi El-Kaide'nin falanca sitede yayınladığı falanca itikattan dolayı mıdır? Bize böyle saçma sorular sormayın. Biz askere gitmiyoruz. Çünkü ellezina amenu yuqatiluna fi sabilillah vellezina kafaru yuqatiluna fi sabilit tagut. Öyleyse size tagut dedikten sonra nasıl gelip size askerlik yapalım? Biz münafık değiliz. Size tagut dedikten sonra gelip size askerlik yapacak değiliz. Oy kullanıyor musunuz? Oy kullanmamanızın El-Kaide'nin falanca sitede yayınlamış olduğu falanca broşürle bir alakası var mıdır? Euzu billah. Biz oy kullanmıyoruz. Çünkü yaratan kimse hükmetme hakkı da ona aittir. Biz buna inanıyoruz. Yaratıcıya hükmetme hakkını ona veriyoruz. Sizlerin yaratıcıyla hüküm konusunda çekişen zavallılar olduğunuza inanıyoruz. Sizlerin yaratıcıyla hüküm konusunda çekişen zavallılar olduğunuza inanıyoruz. Madem böyle, nasıl bizden oy kullanmamızı bekliyorsunuz? Bize böyle sorular sormayın. Bize böyle sorular sormayın. Ya rafiq ad-darbi hayya nasluku an-nahja as-sawiyya fi sabilillahi namdi naqtafi fihi an-nabiyya nab'athu al-hubba arijan fa'iha al-'atri shadiyya namla'u al-afaqa nuran wa baha'an sarmadiyya ya rafiq ad-darbi hayya nasluku an-nahja as-sawiyya fi sabilillahi namdi naqtafi fihi an-nabiyya nab'athu الحب أريجا فائح العطر شديا نملأ الآفاق نورا وبهاء سرمديا وإخاء صادقا عذبا نقيا أريحيا يا رفيق الدرب هيا خذ يميني يا أخيا هيا يا رفيق الدرب.
Why did he add jihad to ibadat that are pillars of Islam? Why did he add jihad to ibadat that are the pillars of Islam? We all know the hadith on the pillars of Islam that I just mentioned. It's actually the first hadith that I ever memorized in my life as a child. Jihad is not in it.
عبد الرحمن ابن القاسم رحمه الله تعالى said, he's a contemporary alim. He died nearly half a century ago, and he was the one who compiled the fatwa of Ibn Taymiyyah and the works of Muhammad ibn Abd al-Wahhab. In the context of explaining the book, الروض المربع, which is a different Hanbali fiqh book, he said, explaining this exact issue, some consider jihad the sixth pillar, and that's why it's mentioned after the five pillars. He was explaining why Hanabila included in the ibadat with the pillars of Islam. And I had a teacher who used to always attribute it to a specific sahabi, but I was never able to find any direct statement that a sahabi referred to as a pillar. The closest you'll possibly find is what's related in Abu Dawood al-Tayalisi in his Musnad, that Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu said Islam is eight portions, and he included in those eight portions ordaining the good and forbidding the evil and jihad, but he didn't directly say it was a pillar. Those who mention it as a sixth pillar were trying to show its high status in Islam. But when the hadith didn't specify it as a pillar, nor do I know anyone of the early salaf who explicitly referred to it as a pillar, then I believe there's a wide variety of terms and ways to show the high status Islam gave to jihad. No one but a deluded munafiq would diminish or deny the high status Islam gave to jihad, and no one but a bigger full-blown munafiq would pervert its real, true meanings that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave it. And some of the narrations about that hadith on the pillars of Islam, Hajj is mentioned as a fourth pillar. In some, it's changed around with Siyam and mentioned as a fifth pillar. And in another hadith, the messenger gave jihad precedence over Hajj. So do we then say Hajj is a fifth pillar rather than say it's a sixth? Or we say sometimes it's a fifth and a sixth? The messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam specified certain matters under certain terminologies, and we should stick to them, especially since the Salaf didn't use them from what I believe. The messenger, the hadith that I was referring to, the messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam was asked, سُئِلَ أَيُّ الْعَمَلِ أَفْضَلِ, what's the best of deeds? He said, إِيمَانٌ بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ, to believe in Allah and His apostle. They said, what else after that? He said, الْجِهَادُ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. They said, what else after that? He said, حَجٌّ مَبْرُورٌ, to perform Hajj. We can't make jihad a fifth pillar based on that, or a sixth one, but that shows us the importance of this mighty, noble obligation. Ibn Hajar rahimahullah ta'ala, pertaining to this hadith, said, he commented on this hadith, said, jihad was given precedence in that jihad is a matter that benefits everyone, while Hajj benefits only the individual. Or he said it may be in reference to when jihad is a fard ayn. Ulama of Haqq have spoken so highly of jihad in various ways that shows its importance without needing to refer to it as the sixth pillar specifically. Imam Ahmad rahimahullah said, I don't know anything after the obligations more essential than jihad. لَأَعْلَمُ شَيْئًا بَعْدَ الْفَرَاغِ أَفْضَلُ مِنَ الْجِهَادِ. Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah ta'ala had very similar statements. And more important than all those quotes is the ayat of the Quran. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا هَلْ أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَىٰ تِجَارَةٍ تُنْجِيكُمْ مِنْ عَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ تُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَتُجَاهِدُونَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ بِأَمْوَالِكُمْ وَأَنفُسِكُمْ ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ وَتُجَاهِدُونَ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ بِأَمْوَالِكُمْ وَأَنفُسِكُمْ ذَلِكُمْ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. Some refer to ordaining the good and forbidding the evil as the sixth pillar. And the same explanation applies to that.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
وقاتلوا في سبيل الله الذين يقاتلونكم ولا تعتدوا إن الله لا يحب المعتدين. وقتلوهم حيث ثقفتموهم وأخرجوهم من حيث أخرجوكم والفتنة أشد من القتل. ولا تقاتلوهم عند المسجد الحرام حتى يقاتلوكم فيه فإن قاتلوكم فاقتلوهم كذلك جزاء الكافرين فإن انتهوا فإن الله غفور رحيم وقاتلوهم حتى لا تكون فتنة ويكون الدين لله فإن انتهوا فلا عدوان إلا على الظالمين الشهر الحرام بالشهر الحرام والحرمات قصاص فمن اعتدى عليكم فاعتدوا عليه بمثل ما اعتدى عليكم واتقوا الله واعلموا أن الله مع المتقين وأنفقوا في سبيل الله ولا تلقوا بأيديكم إلى التهلكة وأحسنوا إن الله يحب المحسنين.